opportunity to study abroad in Budapest, Hungary, through the Budapest Master's in Math Education program. And in Hungary, they teach math a very different way than we teach it here. They teach it through what's called the discovery method. So they pose a problem, not just like a, here, multiply these two numbers, see what you get. But they pose a problem that makes you connect a bunch of different ideas together. And that was really hard for me at first because it's a different way of thinking. But then I started to understand that that helps me get a deeper understanding of what's behind the math. And then that just made me love math even more. And so then I started to question, well, what else is out there? And again, through conversations with the faculty, I thought, maybe I'll try grad school. And so that took me to Iowa, where I've met some very wonderful people, have a great community around me, so that's very important to me, and studied some fun math. So grad school is very different from Central, I'll be honest. So if you're curious, in math, grad school, you go your first year and you take core classes in three different areas. For me, that was algebra and abstract algebra, something called analysis, and topology, some of which are offered here. And then as you go throughout your graduate experience, you take less and less classes, which was really weird. I went from coming here and taking 16 to 18 credits, and now I have like three. But the goal in reducing your classes is to spend time on your research. So in math, in order to graduate from the doctorate program, you have to prove something that no one's proved before. And so this time without classes is spent solely focused on that. And at the end, when you're done and ready to graduate, you give a defense. And that basically you prove your idea to a group of professors who say you can graduate or please keep working. And so this picture is of my academic brother, Cody right here, his defense. So we got to celebrate when he graduated. And these are some of the people that I'm closest to in Iowa. So that's a little bit of my pipeline. If you have any questions about grad school or like what I did here at Central or anything that I've said, you're more than welcome to ask me after. I can talk your ear off all day. But for now, let's get to the math. Is that okay? All right. So why topological data analysis? This is a great question, and it's motivated by the large amount of data that we have in our world today. So if you just think about your experience, maybe a lot of you wear like an Apple Watch or a Fitbit, and you're constantly tracking like your steps or your sleep, or that can extend to the websites that you visit. All sorts of things, we're tracking data, and that means we have a huge amount of data in our world. And many people have studied it using the typical statistical methods, but we kind of are looking for new ways to pull out details about our data and information that those normal or standard methods might not always have. And so there's this idea of topological data analysis that studies data based on its shape. And so I'll typically refer to topological data analysis as TDA. But the pipeline, because you might ask, data and shape, that to me doesn't go together in my brain. But if you start with some data, there's a way to give it a shape, to make it almost like a three-dimensional, two-dimensional object, which from there then we apply some techniques from abstract algebra, and I'll teach you them, so don't worry, you can hang. And then that gives you a summary of what you see in your data that then can go back to the context that you got your original data from, and provide extra information about what you're seeing. So we'll walk through this step by step. I'll be honest, I spend most of my time thinking about the steps between the geometry and the summary. There's more computational, so if you really like computer science, that's a good spot for the data to geometry. And then the people that we're getting our data from tend to help us with this part. So some things to think about that might cater to your skill set. So the first thing that we need to talk about is a simplicial complex. So this is what's going to help us give our data shapes. So what this is, it's a collection of sets, so groups of objects, where if you have one object in this collection, anything that's smaller than it, in it, is in that larger collection. So if you're in abstract algebra, you talk about the idea of closed. Do I have anybody who's in abstract algebra? Yay, you got to admit. Okay, so this might not mean much, but you're closed under the idea of a subset. So everything smaller is in this collection. So I love pictures and visuals. Here's some elements in a simplicial complex, and we typically identify them based on like their dimension. So in zero dimensions, we just have a point. In one dimension, which you can kind of, maybe this makes sense, you have a line that's between two points, and if you think about, if you take anything smaller, take the points, that's also gonna be in the collection, right? Because we'll have these zero dimensional simplex. If you keep going higher, you get something that's two-dimensional, so a shape or triangle, and then three-dimensional simplices, you just get these types of shapes, okay? So that's the picture that you can think of. And what we need is we need a way to make our data into these simplices. So this is a very simple collection of data, and the one that I like to use is called the Viatoris-Rips complex. And so the way that we get to draw these lines and these shapes on our data is we pick a radius. We just pick one. And then we draw a circle, since this is two dimensions, around each point. And then whenever those two circles intersect, we draw a line between them. Does that make sense? And then when multiple circles overlap, so say you have like three circles overlapping, that's when you'll get the triangle of the two-dimensional simplicity. And part of the thing about TDA is there's a choice in this. So I, as I mentioned, I like the Viatoris-Rips complex for a variety of reasons, but there's many different ways to do this in TDA. Some of them, this one takes a lot computationally when people code it in so that we can apply it to data sets. So they often will try to find better ways, more efficient ways to get the same idea. Okay, so we picked one radius, right? But sometimes that's not super interesting. And so in order to make it more interesting, we say, let's just figure out what happens at every single radius possible. So here is the data that we started with in that last slide. And if we let our radius be one unit, we get this, which maybe you can see, to me, is not much more interesting because there's nothing that's intersecting my circles. But when I make my radius two units, now I get something that's more interesting. Now I get this chain of circles that start to overlap so I can connect the points and get lines. And then if we do it a little bit more, make our radius three units, now I get a bunch of two-dimensional simplices and one that's three dimensions. And we can keep going, letting our radius get bigger and bigger and bigger. And you might have some intuition, if we keep going, those circles are gonna get so big that eventually everything's connected, right? So really, this part where nothing's connected and then this part that's off when the radius or radii are really big, those aren't super interesting. But what's really interesting is these things in the middle as they change. So this is called a filtration because we're filtering it by the radius, but it's all moving in one direction. So I think you can think of this almost as like a directed graph. And we'll see more of that later. Are there any questions up until this point? So now that's the geometry. That's how we get our shape. But now we can think about the algebra. So the tool that we use is something called homology. In an intuitive sense, this just means we're going to count the number of holes. We're going to, it describes the number of holes of a certain dimension in your shape. So in zero dimensions, it's just a gap between things. So you can think of, we're just going to count the number of connected components. one dimension, you'll just get like a hole. Like if you draw a circle and it'll be empty in the middle, and then we'll get bigger. So we won't care about the homology group in this talk, but what we will care about is these Betty numbers. And this simply just counts the number of like K dimensional holes in your space. So in zero, we're just gonna count the connected components. In one, we'll count the loops, and so forth. So to give you a picture, here's a simplicial complex. And if I calculate the zeroth Betty number, I'm just counting things that are connected components. So this point's off on its own, so that's one. This is off on its own, that's two. And then this large chunk is off on its own as well. So here I have three connected components. And how many holes do I have? Well, just this one, right? Because that's the only one that's an empty triangle. All of these other ones are two-dimensional. So here, my Betty 0 is 3, and my Betty 1 is 1. Does that make sense? Okay, your turn. Here we go. I'll do the first two. That way you don't have to count. This one, there's 13 points. So there's 13 connected components, but there's no holes. And same with the radius 1, as we talked about earlier. It's not that interesting. But how many connected components do I have here? You can just show me on your... Two, very good. Any loops? No, right? Very good, 100%. What about in this one? How many connected components? There you go, how many loops? Just one, right? All of this here is connected by one thing, and then the loop, there's only one of those. And then same in this one. The only difference between 3 and 4 is that we get more higher dimensions. And eventually, as we mentioned, everything is going to get connected way out here. And so it's true that if your radius gets big enough, you'll always have one connected component. And eventually that loop is going to get filled in, so you're not going to have anything there. So you can kind of know what you're getting like when you think about a huge radius. So very good. Okay, so now we summarize. That was our algebra tool, and now we say, okay, since we've applied this algebra tool, what do we get? How do we start to analyze what happened? And so the big idea, the buzzword in topological data analysis, is barcode. We summarize our data with a barcode. And the way that we need to do this is by forming an interval where the endpoints are birth, the time of the birth of the feature, and the death of the feature. So think of a feature as like a connected component, a loop, something like that. So if we look, I need to mention one thing. This is, I told you I'm the oldest, right? So this is something that I like in topological data analysis, but there's a thing called an elder rule, because the oldest gets their way, right? So whenever two things get connected, so say this one gets connected to this one, the oldest one stays. We get our way. I know my sisters don't really like that, but the elder one stays, okay? So here you can see, here's a feature, and it gets connected over here. So we would say the one, okay, so let's see. This one comes first, right? This one comes first. And so when this one gets joined to this collection, then whatever we label these two points is what we're going to label these three points, okay? So it just kind of gets sucked in there, and we keep the older one. So, all right.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yeah.
Is the birth and the death, are those radius values, like the radius at which something groups, and then the death is when, like, the beginning of the next something that happens,
yes.
But it's all, is that based on what the radius values are?
Yes, okay. That's true. Or some people will vary time, like we don't have to just vary the radius, but if the radius represents something, then that will be your end point. Yeah, that's a great question. Anything else? Okay, so I sneak peek, here's the barcode. Maybe you can see where it got its name. Maybe like when you go to Walmart and you scan the barcode. This is a very simple one, but they get much more complicated. So what we're doing is here at time r equals 0, I have my 13 connected components. They're born, right? They've just kind of existed. So each of these endpoints represents one of those connected components. And the connected components will all be in blue. And then they live through through radius equals 1, so their interval continues. But most of them die, meaning they get sucked into a one-dimensional simplicity between 1 and 2. So they will all die, but because I have two connected components here, then I'm left with two intervals on my barcode. So I have, you think, like just the number of lines that overlap that interval, there's two. And then as we mentioned, continuing as our radius gets bigger, there will always be one of those connected components. So that's why there's a line that just exists for the whole time. Versus in the situation that we're counting loops in red, a loop first appears when r equals 3, so my first endpoint is at r equals 3, and then we're assuming that it's going to die at r equals 5, so my interval will end at that point. And so this is your barcode, and this is one way that we can summarize our data. As we take biological data, for example, and we then give it back to the biologists, frankly, a lot of the math doesn't mean much to them. They just want to know, how does this apply to my data? And so we have to give them some visual component so that they can say, oh, this matters. I understand this, right? They look at graphs all day long, so this is a way that we can do it. Yes.
How come for like each one of the barcodes, some of them are at like a slight angle? Does that matter a lot within it?
No, that's just my human error.
Oh.
Yeah. No, if it was perfect, right, it'd be a straight line. Okay. But yes. No. Thanks for asking. Maybe someday that'll mean something, but for now it just means my human error. Yeah. Any other questions? Awesome. So this is one way to summarize it. Another way that we can summarize it that you'll want to keep in mind is a persistence diagram. So this is just your normal graph. You can think about it, here's your radius, your birth axis, so the time that it's born, and this is your death axis. And each point is plotted birth, comma, death. So 13 of our points were born at time 0. 11 of them died when our radius became 2 because they got sucked into one-dimensional simplices or two-dimensional simplices. And then at time 3, this is supposed to be 1 point because the one simplicy gets kind of adjoined to the others. And then the one connected component that just lives on forever gets its own point up here at infinity. And then for our loop, it's born at radius 3, and it dies at 5, so there's its point. And this line here represents the line birth equals death. And if you think about it in your human experience, it's really hard to die before you're born, right? And so that's why we have no point on this lower half, and they're all above the line. So this is yet another way to describe our data. And I'll tell you why this might be a better option here in a little bit. But with that being said, I want to take a little bit of a theoretical diversion to show you a little bit about what I'm really interested in. And that would be something called a module, which you don't need to worry about too much because I'll tell you exactly what it means in this context. So in this context, we take an interval, so a section between A and B, and I'm gonna just take for every single little I, so just think any number that you can think of, if it's in between A and B, I'm gonna put a copy of the real numbers at that index, which for me was hard to understand at first, because it's like you're putting a whole collection of the real numbers in one index. But it's okay, it works. So if it's in there, full copy of the reals. If it's not, we're just gonna say it's zero. And nothing interesting happens there. But when we think of these as like vector spaces, so you can think of like R, if you have two copies of R, then between them, I can just take an identity map. You can think of like f of x equals x, right? Just whatever you put in, you get the same thing back. And so when you take this collection of all of these indices, this gives you what we call a persistence module. Persistence meaning we want to see which features persist throughout multiple radii, and then module coming from the like abstract algebra construction of a module, which is really just a space with extra conditions and extra structure. So we're just assigning a copy of the reals to each index in the interval. And here's a picture of what I like to study. So if you think about this in the sense of our loop appeared at r equals 3, so I'm going to stick a copy of r right there in the 3 index. And it lived through 4, so that also gets a real copy of the real numbers. And then it died, so then my indices are no longer in that interval from 3 to 5. So I put 0 at those, and then this becomes the identity map right there. Okay? And these types of structures, you can think of them as directed graphs, or I think of them as quivers. So not the bow and arrow sense, but we call them quivers. Are there any questions? Okay. Wonderful. So the reason that we define these interval modules, I'll kind of summarize this theorem in short, but it says that if I have any persistence module, not necessarily an interval module, but something more general, I can always write it as just adding up a bunch of different interval modules. So it's the direct sum over all of the intervals in the barcode of these interval modules. So when I have my, think about our zero components, you have all of those lines, right? All of those intervals. So if I take each of those intervals in that barcode and look at its interval module and then add it up, it'll always be equal to that persistence module. So it's a really strong theorem that gives us a lot of different ways to think about our data. And so now we summarize it all, and we want to talk about how we analyze this data. And often, as I've mentioned, this depends on where your data came from. So whether it's from the biology lab, or looking at flies, we'll see an example later, but it all depends on the context and what the researchers are actually looking for. And so this often is done in collaboration with the people who are asking you to perform this analysis in the first place. So applications, and then the other thing that people are using to analyze the data is something called stability, which is close to what you think of in stability. But what it's asking is, it's saying if I take my original data set and I change it just slightly, I perturb my data, maybe a little up, a little down, something, do I get about the same thing, right? Because if you make a little change, your analysis should be almost exactly the same. But sometimes it's not, and sometimes it's drastically different. And then we know we don't have a very good analysis of our data. And so we're trying to figure out what are the things that make this a stable analysis. So the stability, it often requires defining what we call a metric, or a measure of distance between modules. And maybe if you think about just when we're thinking in one dimension, if you take two endpoints and you subtract them, you get the distance between them, right? Or if you do that with components, you get the difference. But this is weird because you're actually defining it between like abstract objects. So they're not just numbers, they're actually structures. And so there's many different ideas of what might be good measures of distance, but we need to actually prove that they are. the other thing that I think is interesting that I'd like to share with you is the application side of this. And so a lot of work that I'm familiar with is done in conjunction with the psychology department. And to test out and make sure that TDA is actually a good analysis, we want to show that it's confirmed what we've already found, or what the psychologists have found. And so topological data analysis has done that. It's confirmed this is exactly what we're finding with this normal statistical methods. So it hasn't necessarily built on what that is. But now, as more and more people are interested in topological data, are open to analyzing their data with it, we're finding that topological data analysis can find things in data or in situations that normal statistical methods can't. So I'd like to share one of these with you. And it comes from a paper that a fellow Iowa student shared with me. And it's audio detection or authentication. And so the goal of this paper and these researchers was to identify when a soundtrack has been altered slightly. And there are methods with which this has been done for a while, but often in some situations when your music has been changed in certain ways, those are not able to distinguish the difference. And so they wanted to develop a way where TDA would actually distinguish the difference between those two soundtracks, which is really important when you think about TikTok and YouTube and all of the music copyright laws and things come into play, and so we want to have a good measure. So first we have to take a soundtrack and we have to get it into a way that a computer can recognize it. So with this song No Heroes by Converge, the researchers took a 5-second snippet of this heavy metal song and they put it into this type of analysis. So on the left you have frequency, the colors are measuring decibels of the sound, and as I mentioned, the bottom is a 5-second snippet, so it's measuring time. And let's see, if you apply topological data analysis to it, here in dimension zero, this is what your barcode looks like. So it looks very different than the one that I showed you earlier. So each one of these red is a separate interval in my barcode, and where it's hard to tell that there's many intervals because there are so many. And here, in this persistence barcode, that's the ones for the loops in one dimension. And that's a lot going on. So we want to simplify it, and we talk about what's called a Betty curve. So the Betty curve just counts how many intervals we have at each particular point. And you'll see here where there's many, many intervals right there, our Betty number gets really, really high. Versus here, there's only a few intervals in my barcode up top, so I just have a very small Betty number. And similarly, here in dimension one with my loops. So it's very interesting, but this is where a lot of the computer science aspect developing efficient code to go from point A to this analysis. So I'll show you why this works, or how it works, maybe. Here's a different song. The song's The Morning by Les Loups, both of which I was unfamiliar with when I read this paper. But if you consider here is your original track, what goes into the computer, and here is the Betty curve for each of dimension 0 and dimension 1. And the normal audio analysis methods will do a pretty good job picking out when we add white noise and pink noise. So these are those snippets once we've added those two things respectively. And you'll notice, probably just from the eye test, these Betty curves are very different when you compare it to the original, right? Like this one, whoo, it skyrockets. But, so, that doesn't build on what's been done in the past if it just gives us about the same thing. Both TDA